Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, WrestleZone would like to welcome you to tonight's live event. Before we begin, please be advised that all WrestleZone stars are professionally trained, so please do not copy or imitate anything you see here tonight. Please also be aware that WrestleZone is proud to provide entertainment suitable for all ages, and we ask that you refrain from using any inappropriate language this evening.
Hello and welcome back to the WrestleZone podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. We're here to give you a quick recap on this past Saturday's Blootoon Wrestling Extravaganza. It took place at the Palace Hotel in Peterhead. A really fun night for WrestleZone in association with the Peterhead Community Council. There was lots of charity buckets and hampers going around and part of raffle prizes as well. So it was really great night for wrestling in Peterhead on Saturday. I had a lot of fun, I'll tell you that for free. It was a good night of just plenty of great action that I'm just going to give you a quick recap on in this edition of the podcast, of the WrestleZone podcast. If I've not already mentioned, my name is Billy. I am an absolute WrestleZone dork. If this is the first time you're watching a podcast, we've got previews and recaps of previous events starting from last year and the run up to Aberdeen Anarchy, and we're just going to continue doing that as I hope to get to quite a lot of the events this year for WrestleZone. There'll be one or two that unfortunately I will miss, but we'll try and keep you as up to date as possible through the previews and the like and other podcasts, and through the website swnscotland.com. So let's look at Blootoon Wrestling Extravaganza. Like I said, it took place on the 24th. Today's 27th. No, tomorrow's 27th. I'm all over the place. 24th of February at the Palace Hotel in Peterhead for a Blootoon Wrestling Extravaganza. Kicking off the show, obviously the VIP section. The VIP ticket holder match was a triple threat with Chris Archer taking on Oliver Green and Evan Young, and a match that Archer didn't seem that interested after calling out this challenge. Didn't seem interested in actually getting involved in the early goings, with Young and Green going back and forth with Archer trying to maybe sneak in, get involved, but ultimately getting thrown out of the ring several times during the match. But in the end, thanks to some let's call it ingenuity, well, the referee was distracted. Well, not even through distraction, it was a triple threat match, there's no disqualifications. But Chris Archer took a chain from out of his boot and leathered Oliver Green in the face to pick up the win and the pinfall. So this is Chris Archer's first win in about a year. I think the last time he won was about April last year. I think it was Oliver Green then as well. So that's the first time he's picked up a victory. Tainted win, perhaps, using the chain, but a win nonetheless. So Chris Archer is hoping that puts him back on track when we've got Regal Rumble coming up on March 30th. So we'll see if that helps. Evan Young, great showing. Oliver Green, great showing, until ultimately getting smacked in the face with a chain. Unfortunate for him. But another win for a big win for Chris Archer on his road to redemption, to try and hopefully maybe win the Regal Rumble and become a Triple Crown winner in WrestleZone. Nobody else has managed the feat yet, with Aspen only being the only person to win the Triple Crown and Grand Slam in WrestleZone. There's a lot of people that could go through the Regal Rumble to manage that feat. So we'll see how that works out on March 30th. Kicking off the main show, we had Zach Dynamite taking on TV's Omar Mohamed. Absolute beautiful match. It was a fantastic match that showed a lot of back and forth. That showed a lot of growth in Omar Mohamed, considering their last match at Trinity Center Takeover, which saw Zach Dynamite ultimately win. We saw Omar fight back several times. He was able to harness that rage he had as well. Zach Dynamite came out to the ring with a Mr. WrestleZone mask in hand to try and goad TV's Omar Mohamed a bit more, because why not at that stage? Because Zach Dynamite is a terrible person. He needed to try to goad him. At one point, even put the mask on Omar, which seemed to just enrage, but still harnessed that rage for Omar, who started just wailing on Zach Dynamite. But it wasn't all clean sailing. It wasn't smooth sailing at all because Captain Alan Sterling arrived to try and steal the Shirwani Wadi, Omar Muhammad's Shirwani. Even noting to Blue Thunder, asking him and telling him that, asking him why he was trying to stop him from stealing Shirwani Wadi. But that distraction caused Omar to walk it in, to interrupt Omar when he was trying to do a Thunder Gun Express, turned right into a super kick and a kill shot for Omar to be pinned for the three count. So Zach Dynamite won the victory, but I don't think it really settled anything, and if anything, it just probably enraged Omar further because he was distracted by the buffoonery of Captain Allen. Up next was the outfit, Ted O'Keefe and Murphy taking on the Warriors against low-life entities. And to be honest, it was quite a dominant display by the tag team champions in this non-title match. Brian Tucker and Rhys Dawkins, they tried, they did their best, but ultimately their shenanigans came up to cost them as they just kind of buffooned around a little bit. I'm using buffoon a lot. That's the key phrase for this episode of the podcast, this recap edition. Dawkins put on a really fine performance, even when Tucker was on. Tucker was great. We can't forget that he is a multi-time former tag team champion. But ultimately, these two still don't really have that kind of gel when it comes to being in tag team competition. They seem to get into each other's path, don't have a game plan. Whether if they do or don't, Tucker doesn't remember it. And it just really... It's working against the Warriors, against low-life entities, and when they can't kind of get on the same page. They maybe have the same book, but they're not on the same page when it comes to trying to gain victory. I mean, they've done it. They've won matches. I think it was a handicap match last time they actually won a tag team match. But they do need to possibly reevaluate their tag team because it's not going well for them. Ted O'Keefe and Murphy put on a fine performance. They were in all smiles. I don't know if it's if they've stopped being grumpy because they've got rid of like the waistcoats and all the things that was kind of just all keeping them in. I mean, I know if I'm wearing a really tight jumper, I get really, really annoyed and grumpy. And now they've got vests and t-shirts and they're let loose and they're free to just stretch their arms and clothesline people. We've got a little bit of a tribute to Dino as well, who's on the injured list at the moment with the big strut elbow from Ted O'Keefe. And it was a really, yeah, good performance from the outfit. They put on a great show. And they'll be working towards the Regal Rumble, where we may see the return of Dino. We don't know what the timetable is for his return. And we'll get to see the trio and use that Freebird rule in effect to see where the tag team scene landscape goes. There's some tag teams in WrestleZone they haven't faced just yet, but we'll also see how that goes. We're on the way to Abu Anarchy. Is there going to be a surprise? Is there going to be a big team? We haven't seen this particular team take on the likes of Skull Brawl, Flippy and Drippy. Those two teams are very new, but we could see them facing off on the roads to Abu Anarchy. Well, I'm interested to find out. Up next was their first half main event, was the WrestleZone Tri-Counties Championship, when Caleb Valhalla defended successfully against Connor Malloy. By pinfall, big spear to finish off the match. But the story about this one is just the difference we saw from Station Hotel Showdown, where Connor was very respectful in that match. We saw them have their impromptu battle in January last year, and then fast forward to February this year, and Connor's this cocky, smug, smarmy individual, influenced very clearly by not only the mental breakdown he had from losing to Aspen at Christmas Chaos, but also the influence of Ronan King. We got to see a little bit of a different side to Connor, who put on an absolute... There's no denying he's a fantastic wrestler. That's something that we can't deny. But this cockiness may have cost him because he got arrogant. He got arrogant during this match, and we had to, and Caleb was able to refocus and regenerate and be able to hit that big spear to finish off the match. There was a lot of great counters. There was a fantastic counter on the outside when Connor was trying to use the ring post to lift himself up for a slice bread number two, Sharon Ari, I think it's called. I can't remember. I apologize. Aspen, I'm all over the place. Caleb was able to lift him over into a fireman's carry position, which was stunning. And we also got to see a lot of great counters into German suplexes as well. It was just a really, really fantastic match. A great defense for Kilo Valhalla, for a very game Conor Malloy. We didn't see Ronan get involved. We didn't see Aspen get involved. It was just a straight up one-on-one Kilo Valhalla defending against Conor Malloy, and he was able to successfully do so. So you're still your WrestleZone Tri-Counties champion is Kilo Valhalla. After the interval, we got Mickey Vago with Tommy Raiden taking on Captain Alan Sterling, and turnabout was fair play with TV's Omar Mohammed coming out towards the end to distract Captain Alan, causing him to lose the match, walking into a stunner himself. Captain Alan was game though. He hit his own stunner during the match. We started off the match with him pointing out with Mickey Vago having a kendo, so a Singapore cane, and with Tommy Raiden having drumsticks, that there was just too much wood in the ring and Vago needed to be checked for more wood by the referee, which was a very, very interesting moment of interesting development in the match itself. But no, we got lots of goings on here, Captain Alan. Like I say, for like the Warriors against low life entities, they may present themselves as idiots, but they're very accomplished and very good pro wrestlers, and they make sure that their distractions most of the time work in their favor. So we got Tommy Raiden got ridden by Captain Allen around the ring at one point, which was a sight to behold, to see in the Palace Hotel in Peterhead for Blootoon Wrestling Extravaganza. It was a terrified Tommy Raiden as he was being ridden by Captain Allen around the ring. There was just a lot going on, but a lot of fun. We got to see Mickey Vago do his patented cartwheel elbow, although I saw one on the internet and it may have put his to shame, even though he considers his own one the best in Scotland, certainly. But we got to see a lot of fun stuff in that match as a spectator, certainly. But ultimately, Mickey Vago picked up another win with that stunner, thanks to a little bit of a distraction for TV's Omar Mohammed. A big win as he's looking to build upon main event Vago at the end of last year. And we're looking to see if he'll do well in the Regal Rumble. I think he's got a high chance of doing well in the Regal Rumble. But selfishly, I don't want him to be in a championship match, because I'm rooting to see Avni Anarchy on May 11th. We're going to see fagging and headbagging with him and Gangrel as a team. That's my hope. That's my prayer. That's what we're hoping for here at the WrestleZone podcast. We're hoping to see Fagin and Headbanging as a team. In our penultimate contest of the evening, William Starling and Damien defeated the Foundation of the Future, Ryan Riley and Bruiser Brad Evans, but it was by disqualification. So during the match, William Starling took a couple big bumps at the start of the match. He was getting thrown around and pushed over by Brad and Ryan. Ryan was able to kind of cut off the ring for the Foundation. The Foundation were doing really well. They were doing great. They had Damien a lot of the time. They were trying to cut off the ring, as they do as a fantastic tag team. But ultimately, when things were starting to go awry, is that the word? Awry, Zach Dynamite emerged all in black, because I didn't even notice him when he came into the ring at first. I was like, what's happening? Oh, it was Zach Dynamite. Zach Dynamite came in the ring and started assaulting Damien, when the rest of the Foundation of the Future joined in as well, before William Starling chased them off with Bruiser Brad's own chain. So two chains. Chains are just a dangerous thing to have in WrestleZone, it seems. Two chains a wrapper? Am I misremembering that? I don't know. I'm old. So we've got to see what the Foundation is still determined to break the foundations of WrestleZone, and that didn't change on this evening, where they went after Damien specifically, before William Starling tried to make it safe. The interesting thing for me was watching Blue Thunder on the stage. He was manning the crew, and he even looked like he had a little step. I thought maybe we'll see Blue Thunder try and step in here, but ultimately it was William Starling that made the save for Damien. So that's Mr. WrestleZone, that's Damien, that's William Starling. They've all been assaulted by the Foundation of the Future, and we'll see how that plays out coming soon. Whether that's going to be Regal Rumble, we're going to see that. Usually there's a big tag team match at Regal Rumble, whether we're going to see it there, or we have to wait until Average Anarchy for a resolution and see if the foundation of the future is just that, breaking the foundations of WrestleZone for their own foundation of the future in Scottish wrestling in the Northeast, certainly. And in the main event, Lost Boy Aspen successfully retained the undisputed WrestleZone Championship against Ronan King in an absolutely sublime contest. I will say in other podcasts that there was three absolutely outstanding matches for me personally. Two absolutely outstanding matches. There was all great matches, but the main event, Zach Dynamite versus TV's Omar Muhammad, there were two of the most standout matches of the show. Lost by Aspen, retained against Ronan King, and this wasn't just an easy defense for Aspen. Ronan held his own. He came close quite often. He did a fantastic job. Again, maybe it's the same as Connor, that arrogance came into play quite often as he spent more time trying to engage the crowd and showing off himself. I mean, he is 20 years old. He's got to show himself off a little bit more. You know, he got cocky, he started gyrating, all that kind of stuff. But eventually, as promised earlier in the match, he got tombstoned on his head by Lost Boy Aspen for the eventual win for the pinfall victory. But no, an incredible main event for Blootoon Wrestling Extravaganza for Lost Boy Aspen and Ronan King. And I'll say this in another podcast, I personally think, of what I've seen, this has been Aspen's best title defense as a match, as a spectator. Certainly, it was an incredible match. Ronan King, he may be cocky, he may be young, he may be all these things that you should hate, and you do hate, you boo him, because he's better than us. That's the long and short of it. He's better than us, even though he doesn't have the confidence in himself. T-shirt available at tmail.com/ScottResnet. You can't deny how good he is, though. And I think even though he lost in this match, again, with no interference from Conor Malloy, there was no interference from Caleb Valhalla, which I suspected there may have been, but there wasn't. He's still my firm favourite. He's my number one favourite for the Regal Rumble this year, Ronan King. And this is a setback for him. And it's now going to be up to his character how he's going to bounce back from it. So he lost the Trey Cowies title match at Christmas Chaos, but they did win in a tag team match. Flippy and Drippy were victorious against Skull Brawl at Granite City Showdown, and then he's lost this undisputed title match. But I think bouncing back now, he's got all the confidence in the world. It's now putting that into action, and I still think Ronan King is your firm favourite for the Regal Rumble this year. I don't know how that's going to go, but I suspect we're going to see Aspen and Ronan clash again, because it was an absolutely wonderful contest. As a fan to watch, I enjoyed every second of it. But that's it. That's the recap of Blootoon Wrestling Extravaganza. Nice quick episode, as the recaps always are. We'll have more episodes coming up about this show. We'll have SWM podcast soon. I think it's going to be in March. But if you go to patreon.com/ScottResnet, you can probably find it out this week. I'm working on it today, and we'll get the montage and all that kind of stuff put together, and it'll be ready, hopefully, to go out by the end of the week at the very latest. So go check out our Patreon. Go check out swnscotland.com. Go check out WrestleZone as well, at WrestleZone on X, Twitter, and Facebook. You can find WrestleZone as well. Upcoming events, March 30th, we've got Regal Rumble at Curl Aberdeen. And the tickets are available at ringsideworld.co.uk. And also on May 11th, we've got Gangrel coming to Rich Energy Arena in Aberdeen. Tickets are also available on ringsideworld.co.uk. Go check them out. But that has been the recap of Blootoon Wrestling Extravaganza. What a night. A fantastic night. Raising money for charity and get some great wrestling at the same time. What's not to love? But no, for now, my name's Billy. Have a good one. Enjoy your wrestling.